I'm excited. It's going to be a good day today. Immediately following the service, you heard already, we're going to baptize 9 people. At MCC, we do baptisms big. It's a celebration. And I'm excited about what God is going to do today through really the teaching of the word and ultimately through the baptism at the end of today. You're going to be encouraged by what you hear from some of our people today. I want to talk to you this morning about kind of a thematic thing, the idea of going all in. And when I talk about going all in, check out these nifty t-shirts that our baptism candidates got. Really cool. So you'll see them rocking these in the pool later. When I talk about going all in, what I'm talking about is followership, like following Christ, discipleship, if you will. Now, bottom line this morning, I want to make it really simple for us so that you can remember this. Going all in requires that we pour our lives out for Christ. Going all in requires that we pour our lives out for Christ. So there was a young man who had recently made the decision to follow Jesus. And he was heading to church one morning and he thought to himself, man, I really want to just give it all to Christ. So what he did was he started to write a list of the things he was willing to relinquish to more intentionally follow Jesus. So he writes this list on a piece of paper, and at the bottom of it, he signs his name, and at the end of service, he goes up to the altar, and he lays it at the altar. God, it's all yours. He left church that afternoon and felt, I guess the word I want to use is dissatisfied with how he felt. Like it wasn't enough, almost. So the next Sunday, on his way to church, he thought to himself, you know what I want to do? I want to write a list of the things I'm willing to do for God. Not just the things I'm willing to let go of, but the things I'm willing to do. So he writes this list. He signs his name on the bottom and he puts it at the altar and said, God, this is what I'm willing to do to follow you. And goes home that day and he feels dissatisfied again. He can't figure out why. So the next Sunday he goes to his pastor and he says, Pastor, listen to what I did. I put these 2 lists on the altar. I signed my name at the bottom and I submitted them to God and I don't feel fulfilled. I feel dissatisfied with what I did there. The pastor looked at the young man and said, you would be better served to take a blank sheet of paper, sign your name on the bottom, and say, God, do with it what you will. You see, because true discipleship, to go all in for Jesus, means you're willing to pour it all out on the line for him. Anybody ever heard of Toby Mack? You know, it's a celebration today, so I think we should have a good time in church. I want to show a video, a Toby Mac music video, that speaks to the concept of going all in. So take a look.
I keep swinging for the fences. It's like this heart is defenseless against the passion that's pumping through my veins. Blood, sweat, tears, it's a calling. The flame. To the walls crashing for the rest of my day.
till I die and they put me in the coffin. Yeah. Don't matter if I'm on the road or if I'm recording. Tell me what you think about me, that really ain't important. You know I'm a representative, my implant can't afford to. I only got one life, I'ma get it though. And this is not an act, not a movie, not a TV show. I don't know what quit me, I don't never take it slow. You know I'm on the grind, me and Toby in the studio. Go for the king, what you know about that? Say you going harder, yeah, you say you doing work, but you asking where the couch at. How you doing work? You can use them when you wanna. You only look to heaven when you going through some drama. And when they going through some problems, and that's the only time you call them. I guess I don't understand that life. Wonder why, cause I'm all in. To the day I die.
Till the wheels fall off, till the spotlight fades, I will lift your banner high. Lord, I'll lift your banner high. And till the walls crash in, for the rest of my days, I'll lay it all on the line.
Going all in requires that we pour our lives out for Christ till the day we die. Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 to 27 reads like this. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You're a hindrance to me. You're not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." Verse 24, then Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? What shall a man give in return for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and he will repay each person according to what he's done." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, for the opportunity you give us as a family, really, to go before you in worship and fellowship. Father, right now, as we go into your word, would you teach us something today? Would you sensitize us to the words that will be spoken this morning? God, would you use me simply as your mouthpiece to say exactly what you want your people to hear? Father, we pray that you would change lives this morning by the power of your Spirit. In your name, amen. By way of introduction, Jesus here is speaking to his disciples in Matthew chapter 10, verses 37 to 39, he says something very similar to the effect of, hey, if anybody would be my disciple, they need to deny themselves, take up their crosses, and follow me. But the precursor to that passage in Matthew chapter 10, Jesus reminds his disciples, hey, if you're going to choose to follow me, then likely it may even cause your family to be angry or upset at you. It may provoke a family discord. And then he provides in Matthew chapter 10, and then here in Matthew chapter 16, a picture for his listeners of what it means to go all in, to pick up crosses and follow him. In verses 21 to 23, we just read that account with Jesus and Peter talking. Jesus is reminding his disciples, hey, I'm going to have to suffer. And then he proceeds in the passage we'll look at this morning to remind his disciples that because he will suffer, they will be subject to that same thing. We look at the phrase here, Jesus looking at his, or excuse me, told his disciples, that's grounds for many of us to check out almost immediately. Because we think that what's to follow is really just for those who were close followers of Jesus. Let me rephrase. We think it's for the pastors, or for the elders, or for the deacons, or for the leaders of ministries in the church. It can't be for us, it's for the disciples. I appreciate Mark and Luke's account because Mark reminds his readers in chapter 8, verse 34, that Jesus called the crowd to him. to tell them the same thing. Luke chapter 9, verse 23, it starts off by saying, and he said to all people. Matthew says, if anyone would. There's universal application there. If any, not just the disciples, it's applicable to all people. If anyone would. It's applicable to all people at all times, in all places, anywhere where someone would desire to follow Christ. He says, if anyone would follow or come after me, excuse me. You see, because following Christ is not an achievement, Dietrich Bonhoeffer says it, it's not the achievement of a select few, but the divine command to all Christians without distinction. He says, if anyone would. Would is it's a verb of choice. In other words, those would-be followers, those people who are about to decide whether or not to follow Christ, would have to make a conscious choice. It wasn't an accidental matter. They couldn't just stumble upon a relationship with God. To follow him would require an intentional decision. Here lies the choice of where their allegiance would lie, with Jesus or with the world. If anyone would make this decision to follow me, to come after me, to be my disciple. And then Jesus offers his listeners three characteristics of a true disciple. He says, let them deny themselves. That word deny is to disown in the Greek, or to repudiate. It's not a call to mild self-discipline, but a call to complete and total self-denial. You're renouncing your right to life if you're willing to follow him. It's the same word that's used when Peter denies Jesus three times. To deny. It's to renounce, even publicly, your right to life. If that wasn't enough for Jesus' listeners, he proceeds to tell them, deny yourself, then take up your cross. You see, in the Roman Empire, a convicted criminal, when he was taken to be crucified, was forced to carry his own cross. And this showed publicly that this person, this criminal, was under and submissive to the rule that he was opposing. And Jesus is saying to his disciples, hey, you got to demonstrate your submission to the one who you had originally rebelled against. His listeners would have known immediately what he was referring to by a cross. He was referring to suffering, death, persecution. In other words, look, if you want to follow me, a true disciple should expect to suffer at some point. And in fact, even your own families might be pitted against you, but that's not where it ends. He continues by saying, follow me. Let them deny themselves, pick up their crosses, and follow me. Here's the Greek for a moment. It's written in the present active imperative. Am I right there, Lee? Help me out. Follow me and keep following me. You see, I think Jesus understood that, hey, the second these people encounter suffering, isn't it true for us, the second we encounter suffering, our tendency is to shrink back, to rely on our own devices, to say, you know what, I'm gonna try to work this out on my own. But Jesus says, follow me and keep following me. You see, here's the truth. To follow Jesus doesn't rid us of the stuff of this life. It's not resolute. It's not an answer to your problems. What it is tension and journey. You know, the way I see it, the meaning of words kind of changes over time, right? Like according to the culture or whatever. And I think the same is true for this passage. I think about it, and words like nice used to mean silly, foolish, simple. And now it's used as like a superlative, right? Oh, that's nice. Silly was actually meant to denote something that was worthy or blessed. And now it means something sometimes worthless, vulnerable, weak. What about the word awful? Awful used to be used to describe, it's like a synonym for awesome. The total opposite of what it means today. A couple years ago now, probably, I was sitting with, I think, my little cousin and Pilar's nieces, and we were talking about the meaning of words. What happened was they were in a discussion, and one of her nieces said to somebody, "Hey, you're salty." I was like, "What? You're salty?" So I actually had her sit down and coach me through what salty means. What does salty mean? Right, to you, it means like flavor, right? Like it denotes some type of flavor. But I asked one of the teens there, what does it mean? Attitude. It's like an attitude. You're angry, you're salty. Alright? What about finesse? We would think finesse is to like smooth things over, right? But to our teens here, it means to get one over. You finesse me, you got one over on me, right? Alright, here's one of my favorites. Lit. The past tense of having light, which is what you would think it is, but to our teens today, it means something that's cool, something that's fun, something that's exciting. Now, this is funny because last night I called my little cousin and I said, "Hey, man, I need some words that mean different things to different people," and he gave me like three or four, and then a couple minutes later, his mom called me and said, "Ernie, I got like four more for you." I was like, "Okay, here we go. You too." I didn't even know half of these. What about the word bumping, right? When you think of bumping, you think immediately of bumping into someone or something. No, it means listening to music. I don't get it. How about this one? Sick. Like, I'm sick. I would think I am physically not well. But to this group over here, it means that's sick. That's awesome. All right, here's the last one I want to give you, right? What about, I would use this to describe the Golden State Warriors in their defeat against, I'm sorry, and their win and their victory over LeBron James and the Cavs somewhere in there. Golden State Warriors were dirty. They were so good. They were so good. They were so good. You mad, Ryan? Here's the truth. Just like words in our culture mean different things now, I think the truth is Scripture kind of falls victim to that same thing, right? Like the phrase "deny yourself," we take that as diet, like relinquish certain things, put certain things aside for a season. It's like the whole Lent thing we do sometimes, and then follow me. Tell a teen to follow you, and they might take out their phone and say, "What's your Instagram or Twitter handle?" Follow me just speaks to a false sense of relationship. Like, it's really an opportunity to stalk someone. Seriously, that's all it is. You get updates, you learn about their lives. You don't even have to like someone to follow them. And so the meaning of these words has changed. Become kind of watered down, I think, to some degree. Billy Graham once said, following Christ has been made too easy. It's easy to follow him when our world is safe and comfortable, but when that world shatters, only a secure faith will sustain us. Here's the way I see it. I think what Jesus is saying here ultimately is, hey, following me, Jesus is more than an accessory. Like, it actually costs something to follow Christ. Here's what I want to do. I want to take a couple of minutes to apply this, and we're going to kind of fly through this morning so we can get downstairs and enjoy the baptism. But the way I want to apply this, and don't check out on me yet. The second you hear this, you may be tempted to. But I want us to perform something of like a self-evaluation this morning. I'm going to call it the test of followership. Test of followership or discipleship. The test of going all in. Again, this isn't legalistic, but actually something Paul promoted. That those who follow Jesus should test themselves. The psalmist said it this way, "Search me and know my heart. Try me and know my ways, my thoughts." 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5 says, "Examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Or do you not realize this about yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you fail to meet the test. The Message version says it this way: test yourselves to make sure you are solid in the faith. Don't drift along taking everything for granted. Give yourselves regular checkups. You need firsthand evidence, not mere hearsay, that Jesus Christ is in you. Test it out. If you fail the test, do something about it. So here's what I want to do. I want to look at those steps that Jesus presents to going all in, to followership. And as we go through those steps, think about them for yourself. Kind of try to evaluate where you stand in each one. If you're taking notes this morning, I want you to write down four P's on your note page. Excuse me, five. Five P's. You know I'm addicted to alliteration, so here we go. Jesus says this. He says, if anyone would come after me, I want to talk for a moment about the idea of willing participation. Willing participation. Here's what I'm getting at. You don't go all in for Christ by putting a Jesus fish on the back of your car. That does not make you a follower of Jesus. You don't go all in. You don't follow Christ by saying all the right words or doing the right things. You don't become a follower of Christ by proxy. You don't become a follower of Christ through your parents' faith. You're not born into it. Huh? You don't just kind of stumble upon a relationship with the Lord. There's a choice that needs to be made. The Berean translation calls it a desire to be had. So the question then is, are you a fan or a follower of Jesus? Listen, here's the truth. We're born with this void in our hearts. And as we grow older, we seek to try to fill that void with things until ultimately, hopefully, we're brought to the place where we realize the only thing that could fill that void is life in Jesus. It's the only way you find fulfillment. And so that desire is really just the seed that leads to us making a decision to say yes to Christ. And many of us are there already, some of us are not. So it goes from desire to decision. The next P I want to look at is perspective, a change in perspective. Following Christ is marked by a change in perspective. Jesus says, let him deny himself. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself. The hardest person in the world to deny is ourselves. It's our carnal selves, the flesh, the thing that's egocentric and wants to put us on the throne of our hearts. That's the reason why when we hear things like let him deny himself, we hear people talking about not denying ourselves, but denying ourselves things. Jesus doesn't say, hey, deny yourself stuff. He says, deny yourself. We make it about consumption when Jesus is saying this is more about commitment than it is consumption. It's not dieting, it's denial. You see, self-denial is a necessary condition of discipleship. We spoke about the idea of submission to the Lordship of Jesus Christ last week. That's what this is about. It requires us to shift our focus from being me-focused to being God-focused. That's what I'm talking about by a change of perspective. It's when we voluntarily abdicate the throne of our lives and give it over to Jesus. It's your will, not mine, Lord. Here's what I don't think Jesus is suggesting. I don't think he's saying, hey, I want to turn you into a zombie or a robot. What he is calling for us to do is to renounce self-centeredness. It's all about me. Self-importance. Self-pity. Self-pleasing, self-reliance, self-righteousness. I guess what I'm getting at is the whole idea of selfish living. Let it go. That's what he's saying. Oswald Chambers said, God nowhere tells us to give up things for the sake of giving them up. He tells us to give them up for the sake of the only thing worth having, life with himself. How many of you guys have ever bought or sold a car before? Yes? Yeah, okay. Obviously. Not obvious, but okay. I just bought a car recently. And what came with that car was not just the key or the car, but also what? A manual, right? Paperwork, all right? A title, right? So when I bought that car, what the previous owner of that car was doing was he was renouncing ownership of that car. He said, it's all yours. So like now I can take that car and I can change things. I can take out the seats. I can take out the steering wheel. I can remove the engine, put a new engine in. And you know what that old owner can't say? He said, it can't say, hey, you can't do that to my car because it's my car. You see, when we submit to the Lordship, when we say no to self, what we're saying is, hey, God, you can have ownership of my life. It's your will, not mine. He said, let him deny himself, take up his cross. I want to talk to you for just a moment about the idea of persecution, suffering, ultimately death. This is another phrase that kind of gets lost in the culture. How many of you have ever heard someone make a statement like, my cross to bear is blank. This is my cross to bear. And usually what it's filled in with is an ailment, a sickness, a horrible boss. For some of us, it's our husbands or our wives, or our kids, maybe. That's not what Jesus is talking about here. The cross Jesus is referring to, it results from walking in his steps and embracing his way of life. It results from being persecuted because we've made the conscious, intentional decision to follow him. It results from living out our faith in the workplace, in our communities, and sometimes even in our homes. It results from standing up for what's right in the face of what we know is wrong. You see, because you've made the decision to follow Christ, if you have made that decision, you're susceptible to suffering. Paul calls them persecutions and afflictions. And ultimately, even possibly death. Look, following Jesus means you're pouring your life out for him. You're laying it out on the altar. You're taking up your cross. So Jesus, earlier in Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 and 23, we read it earlier, Jesus rebukes Peter. He rebukes Peter. You see, I think the reason for his rebuke is because Peter's promoting a kind of like a crossless Christianity, right? And Jesus knew, no. Christianity without the cross is not Christianity. And I think the reason he rebuked Peter is because it sounded strikingly familiar to the time he was tempted by Satan. Here's the deal. When we confess Christ, we embrace his dying on the cross. But we also accept the reality of a cross for ourselves. So desire leads to decision, right? Then we have denial, which could ultimately lead to death. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2 says this, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God. Here's the choice part of this, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is your spiritual worship. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. By testing, you may discern what the will of God is, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Present your bodies as living sacrifice. But why, Paul, a living sacrifice on an altar is going to want to squirm off the altar, isn't it? Now, I think that's why Paul tells us to die daily to ourselves, because it's you're living out your commitment to sacrifice, to pour it all out on the line for Jesus. Don't be conformed any longer to this world. This world is all about me. It's all about me. Paul said it this way. Really, this is my prayer that I would adapt this to my life. He said in Galatians 2:20, it says, I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. I want to look at just for a moment this idea of persistence. Persistence. I think Jesus is saying here, don't stop. I know the temptation is real to stop following whenever you face these different trials, tribulations, the sufferings, persecutions, afflictions, but don't stop following me. He's talking about devotion here. Be with Christ for the long haul. Walk with him. Follow him. Live with him a long life's journey. Persistence. The last P I want to look at is this idea of an eternal promise. You know, if we were to just look at those first three and or four and kind of stop there, it would be like sucking on lemons for the rest of our lives. But there's promise in the end of this. There's promise. What Jesus said in verse 25, "For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? What shall a man give in return for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done." We're almost done. I'm going to ask the worship team if you guys would join us. But here lies the paradox of Christianity, right? You guys remember as kids, finders, keepers, losers, weepers, right? Jesus is saying here, hey, finders, losers. Losers are keepers. Isn't that an awesome promise? And when I think about it, we live in a society, in a world of finders. Like we dabble in spirituality and find what we want in there and we hold it, but really we don't take this whole book into account. We take what we want and we leave the rest. It's a half-hearted commitment. And what Jesus is looking for here is a no-hoarding allowed type of commitment. It's the type of commitment that says, I'm prepared to lay my life down, to pour it all out on the line for Jesus in order to find my life. So here's a question for you. Where do you stand on the test of followership? It's a self-evaluation. Remember, I'm not asking you for your answers, but think about it. We're going to pray in just a moment. If you would bow your heads and close your eyes, I want you to... This isn't one of those things that you leave here and you think about it for a week. No, no, no. Think about it now. Think about where you stand on the test of followership. Do you have this desire to go all in, but maybe haven't taken that step? Or have you said yes to Jesus, but kind of stumble on the part of submission, saying, you know, it's all yours, God. Have you voluntarily chosen to take up your cross? Are you following and continuing to follow Christ? And Jesus presents to us two approaches to life we can take. The first one says this. It says, live for yourself. Ignore the cross. Follow the world. Save your life for your own sake. Gain the world. Lose your soul. The second approach says this, deny yourself, take up your cross, follow Christ, lose your life for his sake, forsake the world, promise, keep your soul. Where do you stand? The question today is simple. Determine for yourself if you're a fan or a follower. Can we pray this morning? Heavenly Father, thank you for your word that challenges us, but also promises good things to those who would follow you. Lord, would you, even as we sit here and kind of quietly reflect on our lives, on this whole idea of the test of followership, would you challenge us, convict us if you have to, God? Or to go all in for you. To make a declaration that says, I'm not going back to my old way of life. This is who I am. I'm a follower of Jesus. Father, for those of us who haven't made that decision to follow Christ, would you encourage us to do that even this morning? And for those of us who have been believers for a long time, would you remind us of the importance of living out a sacrificial life? And it's easy for us to become assimilated to the culture. God, would you bring to mind, Lord, if we've gone too far? Father, we thank you. And even as we kind of sit here and reflect, that you're speaking to our hearts and changing us. It's in your name we pray. Amen. This morning, I'm going to ask our baptism candidates and those who are helping in setup, if you guys would head downstairs. I'm going to challenge you guys, congregation, join us downstairs. Let's support our people as they make this public declaration of their faith. Amen.